Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Sunday service. We just are so blessed that you're joining us, and we just pray the service this morning ministers to you in an incredible way. Amen? Okay, let's get into the Word a little bit before Pastor Wayne comes up. We're going to talk a little bit about total commitment. Total commitment. We hear a lot about commitment today in different causes. People stand up for different things, and they support the causes that are favorable to their heart. So let's begin by defining that word, commitment. I'm going to go back to the Webster's 1828 dictionary, and here's how the word is defined. An agreement or a pledge to do something in the future. A state or an instance of being obligated or emotionally impelled. Now, it's one thing to become committed to natural causes, worldly causes, raising money for this, supporting that, right? But what about being committed to spiritual causes, spiritual things? Let's go over in our Bibles this morning to 1 Peter chapter 2. We're going to look at verses 21 to 25. 1 Peter 2, 21 to 25. For to this you are called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that you should follow his steps. Whose steps? The steps of Jesus, who committed no sin, nor was deceit found in his mouth, who when he was reviled, did not revile in return when he suffered. He did not threaten, but committed himself to him who judges righteously, basically saying he committed himself to the Father, who himself bore our sins in his own body on a tree, that we, having died to sin, might live for righteousness, by whose stripes you were healed. A scripture that we use all the time in standing in faith, believing, and for healing. At verse 25, for you were like sheep going astray, but have now returned to the shepherd, your overseer of your souls. So what are we really seeing when we read these verses here? There's some things that we are to commit to God. Now we can read those verses and just focus in on verse 24 when it talks about by his stripes we're healed. But we need to read it in the context of all those verses. And what it's really showing us are there some things we as believers, as children of God, need to be committed to. We see this in the life of Jesus right here, 1 Peter 2:24. But committed himself to him who judges righteously. Judges righteously. Now, if our Lord committed himself to the one who judges righteously, think about that. Shouldn't we be doing the same thing? So as children of God, we need to really then question, well, then spiritually, what am I to be committed to? What am I to be committed to? Right? So let's look at a couple of things. Number one, the preaching of the Word of God. I am committed to the assignment of preaching the Holy Word of God. Now, that doesn't mean that you're going to stand behind a pulpit, but you can be someone that shares the gospel with your family and friends. When an instance comes up and God gives you that open door, share the Word of God, right? We're committed to preaching the Word of God. Titus 1:3, but has in due time manifested his word through preaching, right? Through the preaching is how God gets his word out, which was committed to me according to the commandment of God, our Savior. So we see something right there. We're committed to preaching the word. Number two, preaching the gospel. Now you could say it's the same thing, preaching the word, preaching the gospel, yes. But it's also my responsibility to spread the gospel. I minister it one-on-one to different people, and then I spread it. What's a good way of spreading today? You got the internet, right? You could put a scripture on every morning. You can share the services that Pastor Wayne and I are preaching, or Reverend John in his site, Simplicity. Take those words and share the gospel with people that you encounter. And there's people that you don't even know will tune into, hear what you share on the internet. 1 Corinthians 9:17, this is New Living Translation. If I were doing this on my own initiative, I would deserve payment. But I have no choice because God has given me this sacred trust. So the things we share, as we share these things, we're not doing it for money. We're doing it because here, we're committed. God's given this to me as a sacred trust. He's entrusting me. He's entrusting you with sharing the gospel. Number three, we're committing our way. We need to commit every decision we make to the Lord. Psalm 37:5. Commit your way. It's right there. Commit your way to the Lord. trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. Now, here's a way you could read this. Commit yourself, commit your way to the Lord. The Lord, Jesus, is the Word. Commit your way to the Word. Trust the Word, because God's going to bring that Word to pass in your life. He says in his Word, he's watching over his Word to bring it to pass. Number four, we're to commit our works. Begin each day reading the Word, prayer, praise. Start your day the right way and give that time. Give your first fruits to God, not so much in the finances, but in yourself, in your life. And it always opens the door when you commit your work for the day and you're starting in him, starting in the Word, starting praising him. He opens the door for direction and completing the daily assignments that you have programmed for your life. You may have plans. You may have they used to call it a day timer, where you'd write everything down that you're going to do. Today, a lot of it's in your phone, right? And you have all these plans and these assignments and these appointments. Well, things change from minute to minute. But when you begin your day and commit that work to the Lord, he will watch over it and establish it, and many times rearrange things in ways that you don't even understand why they're being arranged. Proverbs 16:3, let the Lord lead you and trust him to help you. Number five, we're to commit our soul. When we're submitted to God and his Word, when we're living the Word by the power of the Holy Spirit, no matter what's going on around us, there is a peace that protects us intellectually, emotionally, every aspect. It protects our will, every aspect of our life when we commit our soul. Because what is the soul? Our will, in our mind, intellect, will. It's all together that God will watch over and protect it. Do you know how many emails I've gotten this week of different things that people have sent me and Pastor Wayne that if you read it for face value, you could walk in fear. You can just say, my God, what is happening all around us? What is happening to the economy? What's happening, right? But when I commit my soul, when I commit my mind to the Word of God, to the Lord Jesus Christ, to the Father, and to the Holy Spirit, supernatural peace that passes all my understanding, my natural understanding, will always rule and reign in my heart and mind. 2 Timothy 1:12, for this reason, I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know in whom I have believed, and I am persuaded that he is able to commit what I have, to keep what I have committed to him until that day. What's that basically telling me? There's things that are going to happen right here. Nevertheless, I'm not ashamed to say what the Word says, to stand on his promises. And people could look at you as like, what are you, crazy? You believe that stuff? No, I don't believe that stuff. I believe God, I believe his Word, and I know he's watching over it to bring it to pass, no matter how in the natural it looks impossible, for what I'm standing in faith, believing him for, to come to pass. Number six, we are to commit our cause. Job 5:8, but as for me, I would seek God, and to God I would commit my cause. How many times we've ever read that? Commit a cause? What is that talking about? It's so interesting that when you continue reading the rest of that chapter here in Job chapter 5, just watch some of the blessings of total commitment to God. Verse 17, he will correct us with his Word. Oh, come on, Pastor Marianne, that's a blessing to get corrected by God? Yes, it is, because I'd rather be corrected by God than go through something that's going to destroy me or destroy my family. Verse 19, he delivers us when we're in trouble. No evil befalls us. Verse 20, he will take care of us in famine. Think about all the little babies right now, and they can't find baby formula. You know what? Thank God for a godly mother who knows how to trust God. And God will make a way and provide provision for that little child in a way that the world can't even do. If God can multiply the bread and the fish, if he could multiply the oil and the flour, God's going to bring provision to any mother that's watching today and you're frantically worried how you're going to feed your child. God will provide. He's the God of more than enough. You just keep seeking him, standing on the promises of God. You don't know. I've heard stories and testimonies where people were out down to their last bit of food, and the mother gets up in the morning, goes by the front door, and someone leaves a bag of groceries. Nothing is impossible for our God. He supplies all of our needs. Verse 21, He will hide us from negative words that come against us. Listen, not everybody's going to like you. Not everybody's going to love you. Not everybody's going to understand you. And they're going to say things about you. But when those words come towards you, negative criticism, backbiting, listen, you got the blood of Jesus bloodline around you, and those words go right back to the person that said them. It's just the promise of God. It's right here in verse 21. Verse 25, He gives us assurance of our children's safety. Today, children in school, the shootings, all the different things that are happening, even in churches, what does He say? I'm going to protect your children. Me and Pastor Wayne, we stand on that promise for everyone that's a partner and a member in this church. You are our spiritual children, and we pray Psalm 91 over you every day, the blessing of the week. All the partners, every week, you get a blessing that God gives us to pray for you every week. We're praying over our children, our own natural family, and our spiritual children. So what are we seeing here really this morning? We're seeing the definition of commitment. We're seeing six reasons in line with total commitment. Preaching the word, preaching the gospel, committing our way, committing our words, committing our soul, committing our cause. So here's the big question as far as paying our tithes and making our offerings. Why would we not commit to do that in the word when we know it opens the door for every blessing financially and every blessing spiritually, mentally, emotionally, and socially? It's an insurance policy. So I encourage you today, pay your tithes, make your offerings. You can never outgive God. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you that we are a people, the children of God, committed to you, committed to your word, and understanding that we cannot do it in our own strength, not by our power, not by our might, but by the mighty Holy Spirit who indwells every child of God. And we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. We'll get ready to worship the Lord with these worship songs, and then get your Bible and your pen, your notebook ready as Pastor Wayne comes up and ministers the word to you. Amen.
Well, good morning, everyone. Thank you for tuning in to the Word of God. The power of God's message today will change the course of your life for the better. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to continue teaching on what I was started last week, learning to submit to our will to the will of the Father. Learning to submit our will to the will of the Father. Why do I say learning? Because you have to learn how to do this, because it is not our normal nature to do this. When you get born again, yes, we say the prayer of salvation and we receive Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. That starts the learning process. On that day, you begin to start learning how to live for Christ, live in the kingdom of God, understand the principles of the kingdom and how the kingdom operates and works. So it's a learning process. So prior to salvation, man is not submissive to God. He is not submissive to God. If he was, he wouldn't have needed a Savior. We'd have been submissive to God and been doing it right all along. No, mankind is inherently evil. So when you receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior, the process of regeneration begins. All right? You become saved, a saved child of God. You are a new creature in Christ. But now you have to renew your mind. You have to begin to line up your soul and your body to the will of the Father who dwells within you through the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, all this is a process. So I'm talking about this because submission is something that man, and again, mankind, is not inherently willing to do, submit. They don't even like the word submit, all right? But if we're going to actually live in the kingdom of God, then we must submit our will to the will of the Father. This is something we have to learn to do. So, what have we learned so far? Scripture tells us that mankind will establish his own righteousness when he refuses to submit to God's righteousness. Now, that's what I've been talking about here, is that because man is inherently evil, we decided to do that when Adam and Eve decided to disobey God, they decided to disobey God and obey Satan. So consequently, because of that, mankind is born into this world inherently evil. We are not willing to submit. It's just part of our nature. So Scripture tells us that when we don't submit to God, then we will establish our own righteousness. God has an established righteous way to live on earth and in heaven. All right? So consequently, that's the established righteous way we live. That is not going to change to fit itself into our perspective of life. No, we have to change so that we fit properly in the kingdom of God. Now that requires us to learn how to submit. Now, if we don't submit to God's righteousness, then what mankind is inherently able to do is to establish his own state of righteousness, what he, man, calls righteous. So man has his established state of righteousness and God has his. We see that in society. You can look at all through society and you'll find that mankind has established a level of righteousness. But you'll also find is that man's righteous standard is constantly changing. And what we find is, when you obviously look at it and watch it, you will realize that it's changing for the worse instead of for the better. It's getting worse and worse and worse through the course of time. Why? Because, again, mankind is inherently evil. He does not know how to live, nor even desires to live a righteous life. Now, taking that into consideration, and that we, all of us, came from that mindset. Now that we're saved, now you see why we have to learn how to be righteous children of God. We cannot expect God to love us while we're still living like the world. So consequently, what we find is that God has patience with us. He extends His grace and mercy toward us through the course of time so that we can, whatever speed that we can, begin to try to live a righteous life. What mankind does, though, is he gets frustrated because he uses religion to be able to become righteous. And religion does not enable him to become righteous because it is a mental telepathy. It is not a heart telepathy. So consequently, what ends up happening is he gives up trying to be righteous under the standards of God written in the Holy Scriptures and just simply says, I'm going to establish my own righteousness and this is the way I'm going to live the rest of my life. And that's what mankind has done. And so many people who have set out on the right track to be righteous under God's standards gives up and joins him. Now, what's interesting is there are many today who are calling themselves Christians, but living under the standards of the world. You cannot do that. God does not say, oh, okay, I love you just the way you are. If that's what you want to do, I still love you. Love is still there. God so loved the world and all of its evil. He still loves the whole world. And is the world lovable? No, it's filled with hatred and variance. God does not love that stuff, but he does extend his love, grace, and mercy toward mankind. Now, what ends up we see this picture is that we realize that the only way we can change the course of this is to say goodbye to the standards of the world and totally commit ourselves to the righteous standards of God. Now, we can't do that in and of ourselves. What we find is, and this is where I sort of left off last week, what we find is that we absolutely must have the indwelling Holy Spirit to show us the path every day so that we, of our own free will, can choose to do the right thing under every given circumstance and situation. Now, we learned that if we are going to move from being an ordinary Christian to an extraordinary Christian, we must submit our will to the will of our Heavenly Father. So it's a requirement of us to submit. Now, there's that word again that people don't like, the word submit. If we're actually going to at least try to live a good, moral, righteous life under the principles of Almighty God, the only way we can be successful is to totally submit our free will to the will of the Father. That means while we're submitting, it's His will, not ours. It has to be that way. It's His will working in our life, not ours. So we don't give up. We don't give up our free will. You know, give it up or throw it away. No. What we do is just simply take the free will that God has given to us and we actually submit it. Now, the word submit means to come down under. To come down under. So when we submit, we come down under something. What are we coming down under? The will of the Father. We're allowing the will of the Father to take predominant ordination, if you want to put it that way, control over our lives. So it's not my will anymore, it's the will of the Father. I didn't give up my free will, I'm just simply submitting to it. I'm coming down under His will. I'm going to live my life according to the will of the Heavenly Father. It requires our submission. Now we learned that mankind has been given a right to choose whom he will serve. That's what Joshua was talking about. You can serve, he told the people, the Hebrew people. He says, you can serve the gods of this place, the Amalekites and places we're going into right now, or the gods of your fathers that were before the flood. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. So your free will has been given to you by God so that you have a right to choose whom you will serve. So you will either serve the standards of this world and the god of this world, Satan, or you'll serve the standards of the kingdom, and the god of the kingdom, our Heavenly Father, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit. You will serve, you will, of your own free will, you will choose, you will serve one or the other. It's not that you can stay in the middle and serve nobody. There's no such thing. You're living in a delusion if you think you can do that. You can't do that. The only thing you can do is choose one or the other. There's only two choices here. There's only one, two choices. So you either choose to do one or the other. Now, Satan entices us to live in the world system. What? Through what? Our flesh, what Paul refers to, the Apostle Paul refers to as the flesh. The flesh hungers for everything to please our body, all our five senses. It wants to be pleased. It wants a fancy car. It wants a mansion for a house. It wants women everywhere or men everywhere. It wants all these lustful things because Satan uses lust. God uses love. So you can use the kingdom of lust and like the kingdom of lust, or you can choose the kingdom of love and like the kingdom of love. It's, again, choice. You choose one or the other. That's what your free will is all about. Now, we learned at the point of salvation, at our point of salvation, the Holy Spirit comes to dwell within the new believer, and the Holy Spirit enables us to do what we could never do before. Enables us to do what we could never do before. What's that, Pastor Wayne? The Holy Spirit enables us to do the will of God. The Holy Spirit enables us to do the will of God. Now, what is that telling us? That means prior to salvation, you couldn't do the will of God if you tried to. Why? Because you don't have the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. You are, prior to salvation, inherently evil. Evil cannot do the will of God. You have to be righteous to do the will of God. I'm explaining these in these terms because I want you to understand this is why people of the world cannot serve God. And that's why they get frustrated and then they end up angry with God because God won't listen to them on their terms. It's not that God won't, it's because they are inherently evil. God will have nothing to do with evil. So how do you change the evil to something that's good? You must receive Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world, as your personal Lord and Savior. And that means you have to take your free will and you have to submit to the Heavenly Father and receive His Son Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. Then the blood of Christ cleanses you from all unrighteousness. And now your unrighteousness then is not the thing that's keeping you from being a holy, righteous child of God. Now you're washed clean and now you're pronounced righteous by who? The Heavenly Father. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 20. So that means that consequently then, now you have the right to choose to be submissive to the kingdom of God. Now here's the other thing. In the same perspective, even though you're now saved, a saved child of God, you can also still choose to choose the way of the world. And adopt or adapt worldly principles into your new kingdom life. You can still choose to do that. Now, if you choose to do that, think about how your Heavenly Father might feel about that choice. I'm just painting a picture here. Just think about how your Heavenly Father might think about you've accepted Christ as your Savior. You're now a saved child of God. The blood of Christ has now washed you clean. And now you still, even at that point, have choosing to live some principles according to the world. How long do you think I'm going to get away with that? 1 John 1, 9 says that we can confess our sin and He's faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. The only way you can get around that and get back under the grace of God is to confess what you've been thinking and doing or saying. You have to confess it and say, you know what? I made some choices that are absolutely ungodly. And I've been adapting and taking ungodly principles from the world and trying to make them mine here in the kingdom. Now I'm wondering why the kingdom's looking at me like, what is wrong with this person? That's what's wrong. You're living halfway between two kingdoms. And guess what Jesus said about that? In Revelations, He says, when you are lukewarm, you make me sick to my stomach, is what God said. I vomit you out. You become vomit to Almighty God. Why? Because you're trying to be living in the righteous kingdom of God and at the same time adapting worldly principles into your life. It's not going to happen. You think vomit is going to enter into the kingdom? Well, I'm saying these things because it's in the scripture. It's in the scripture for a reason. Because God knows that this is what people do. Look, we have to learn to submit our will, our free will, to the will of the Heavenly Father. Now, the Holy Spirit comes to help us to do these things. How do we know that? Because Philippians chapter 2, verse 13. Philippians 2, verse 13 says, For it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do. Both to will and to do. So you can say, okay, I submit my will to the Heavenly Father, and then you go out and do something else. No. Who's helping you inside of you both the will and to do of His, God's, good pleasure? It's the Holy Spirit. Now, without Him, you're not going to make it all the way to the kingdom. You might be saved, accepted Christ as your Savior, but you have to what? Submit to the Holy Spirit. Now, this is the thing about the church that I feel is a major, major problem. Is because many churches never, ever speak of the Holy Spirit. Everything they teach is academic. It's all for the mind. And here I'm trying to show you is, if you really mean, and you really have an intention of actually getting into the kingdom, you are not going to get there without the God, the Holy Spirit, working with you to accomplish that goal. You absolutely must have the presence of the Holy Spirit working with you every second of your life, even when you're sleeping. Many Christians have told me that they have insomnia, that they can't sleep. Well, what's that telling me, really? It's telling me this. It means you, as an individual, have yet to contact the concept of the Holy Spirit working in your life. Because if the Holy Spirit was totally helping you and you were totally submissive to the Holy Spirit, you would sleep like a baby every night of your life. Well, Pastor Wayne, I got to worry about some things. For what? When did worry ever fix anything? It doesn't fix anything. The reason I can go to sleep at night, don't you think there's some things that I can think about? Sure, there's plenty of things that I could think, well, this could go wrong, and that could go wrong, and this could be wrong, and that could be wrong, and that one, oh, that could happen. That. I tune it all out. Why? Because I am totally 100% confident of the Holy Spirit within me. And how can I be so confident in Him, the Holy Spirit within me? It's because I have a long time ago totally submitted my free will to the Holy Spirit. And I've let Him to be in control all the time. Now, does that mean that I know all the answers about everything all the time? No, I have to stop. I have to get alone with the Lord. I have to pray. I have to think. I have to focus. I have to meditate, right? Because my soul is my will, intellect, and emotions, the three areas of understanding, whether it's here in the physical or in the spiritual realm. So I still have to submit and allow the Holy Spirit to speak to me. Sometimes I don't hear anything, so I have to go to the Word, and I have to get the Scriptures, and I have to read the Scriptures. And then through the course of the Scriptures and prayer, what ends up happening? He shows me what to do. Now, does that take time? Yes. Is it something like you could say, couldn't it be nice if you just said, Holy Spirit, just tell me what to do? Well, yes. It's like any person. I used to work and be the trainer for when the alarm company would hire new trainees. They'd always give them to me. Why? Because I was the only one who had the patience with them to actually teach them how to do what they had to do. All right? Well, that's the same situation here. I have to learn. I have to learn. That's what I said to work when I first started. This whole thing is about learning to submit our free will. You have to learn to submit. How does that work? It takes time. It takes effort. It takes focus. It takes concentration to make this happen. So the Holy Spirit is there to help us to get all the way into the kingdom of God. We are in the kingdom now spiritually, but physically and mentally, emotionally, all right? These things still got to be transformed. That's why Apostle Paul tells us in Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service, and to be conformed to the image of God and the power of God, of what God wants to do in your life, changing the course of your mind, a complete metamorphosis of how you think and interact and respond to the Holy Spirit. So here's the question. Why is God working in us to do His will? Why does God do this? Why does the Holy Spirit need to be there to work with us? Why is this important? Because it takes our cooperation, our submission, and our obedience to bring about the work of God, to bring about the work of God, or bring about the will of God. It requires our cooperation, our submission, and our obedience. If we don't cooperate, if we won't submit, and if we won't obey, how can then God work with us? He can't, because you must. You're basically saying, no, I have to get done today what I want to get done. Now, is that submitting your free will? No, you're basically saying, not now, God, later. I'm busy. I got a lot of stuff to do. That is your will speaking, basically telling God, I got no time for you and your nonsense. Just go away, and when I'm really got time, I'll get back to you. That's what you're saying to God. So you either submit your will or you don't. Now, if you don't submit your free will to the will of the Heavenly Father through the power of the Holy Spirit, then guess what? There's only one other will that's left, and that's the will of the world. So you can say you're a Christian all day long, but you're still doing every day, doing whatever the world tells you to do. You wake up every morning, you go out and you put the TV on, turn it on full blast, so if you're not in front of it, you can still hear it, and you just drill that stuff into you. Just absorb it like a sponge. But will you absorb the Word of God like a sponge like that? No. So, consequently, what you find is many people are saying a lot of things about who they are and what they do, when in actuality, their actions show something completely, totally different than the truth. Statement: a person does not give up his free will. He exercises his free will. You can't give up your free will. That's who you are. God put it in you. You're free to choose. No matter what Satan thinks or no matter what God thinks, you are free to choose of your own volition. You will always have a free will because that is how God made you to be. Note, God wants His children to be leaders. God, the Heavenly Father, wants His children, born-again believers in Christ, He wants His children to be leaders. But the problem is most of His children want to be followers. God did not require, does not, never make you. Born-again Christians are not born again to be followers. They're born to be leaders. To lead who? To lead what? To lead the lost to Christ. You have to lead them because they're not going to come. They have to be led. There has to be something about you that becomes like an aura or just an attraction, right? So that's why God within you is the hope of glory to the people of the world. God inside you is the hope of glory to the world. What is it? He wants you to be leaders of men, not followers. So if you're a follower, guess what you're going to do? You're just going to follow whatever the world is doing and say whatever the world is saying. Does God want you to be a child of God and follow what the world is doing and say what the world is saying? No, He wants you to be leading the world to what God is saying and what God is doing. Stop being a follower of the world and be a leader to lead people out of darkness into the kingdom of God. Matthew chapter 7, verse 13 and 14 says this: "Enter ye in at the straight gate," Jesus said. Enter ye into the straight gate. Straight gate referring to the narrow gate, a very small gate, a very small gate. Lead people, right? Go ye into the straight gate, enter ye into the straight gate, for wide, because wide is the gate, and broad, a broad way, that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat. In other words, the majority are all going straight to hell. Verse 14, because straight or narrow is the gate and narrow is the way. In other words, the pathway to the gate, and the gate itself is very narrow, which leadeth unto life, Zoe, God kind of life. And few there be that find it. Few there be that find it. So the delusion that many people have is that they think that once I get my ticket to heaven, I can go live like the hell of the world and I'll still get into heaven. Where does that say that in the Bible? Where? It doesn't say that at all. Salvation has nothing to do with getting a ticket to heaven. Salvation is a way how you enter into the kingdom of God. You get into the kingdom. Now, once you're in the kingdom, guess what? You have to learn how to be a kingdom child. You have to learn how to properly live in the kingdom of God. It's a requirement of every last one of us. You can't continue to live like the world and claim Christianity. Statement: the reason so many just follow the masses, is because it's easier. Yeah. Guess what? Once you get saved, it's easier just to follow the world and just call yourself Christian. Yeah. It's so much easier because you already know how that works. You came out of that. So you know exactly how that works. So you just follow the rest of the world and continue to do the same thing you did before. But that's not the reality of the kingdom. The kingdom says, no, you have to say goodbye to that and treat that world like it was dead. The Apostle Paul talks about in Romans chapter 8. Treat it like it was dead. It doesn't even exist anymore. Statement. The reason so many just follow the masses is because it's easier or just to submit to someone else's desires, to someone else's want to. It's just easier. The government's trying to take over anyway. The government's controlling everything anyway. So let's just, you know, it's just so much easier just to do whatever the government tells us to do. Just do whatever they're trying to tell you to do. They're just trying to be the do the right thing. They're just all just trying to do. They would never lie. The government would never lie to you. Never. Oh, Lord God Almighty. Question. Here's the question. What does it take for you to exercise your free will? What does it actually take for you to exercise your free will? You must have your own want to. You must have your own want to. You must have your own desire. You need to own your own want to, your own desire. Not someone else's desire for you, all right? Look, many a mother and father have grown up their children and pressed them and pressed them and pressed them to be whatever the father wanted them to be, a football player or whatever, okay? Sports, whatever situation, you're so good at it, you're going to be the best, you're going to go all the way, you're going to do this, you're going to do that, all right? But they didn't bother to stop to talk to the kid to find out what does he want to do or what does she really want to do? What's in their heart that they really want to do? All right? The Bible says to train up a child in the way he should go. In other words, the mother and father have to find out what's the way my son is supposed to go? I got to find that out by observing and watching and listening and paying attention to him or her, whatever the case might be, to find out where he or she is supposed to go. And that what you do is you support their will, their free will to go where they want to go. You don't know what's going to happen for the future. What many parents do is they force their kid to be somebody that they're not. And then the kid finally reaches a place where he's at the breaking point and finally says, I can't do this anymore. I can't pretend anymore. I hate this stuff, whatever it is. And the mother and father are like dumb, their mouth falls open. I can't believe that you're saying this. It's because you want me to be what you want. It's not right for any kid. Well, it's the same thing here. You're a child of God. You're like a kid in the kingdom. Now you have a free will. Which way are you going to choose? Mommy and daddy are not going to get you to the right place. No, it's not going to happen. You have to make your own choice. You can't rely on someone else's. So if you really want to exercise your free will, you must first have your own desire, your own want to. What do you want to do? What do you want to do? That's what people should ask their children. What do you want to do? Figure it out. I don't know. Why? It's because it's easier just to follow. That's why they say, I don't know. It's easier just to follow. Well, find out what you want to do so we can gear your future based upon what you really would like to do. Put a demand on your kids. God's putting a demand on us as children of God. He's putting a demand on us. Find out what you want to do. Do you want to follow the world? Then follow the world. Be a good worldly person. Go out and live like hell. But if you want to live in the kingdom of God, if that's what you want to do, then I'll help you to live a kingdom life here on this earth. That's what God's saying to us. Proverbs chapter 10, verse 24. This is from the Classic Amplified. What the wicked fears will come upon him, but the desires of the righteous will be granted. So what we find is that you, when you have a desire, you have a want to, and you'd like to make this happen, Lord, this is what I'd like to do for you or for my family or whatever the case might be, then the Heavenly Father hears that and says, okay, if that's what you want, guess what? Then you have the power of God behind you to accomplish that goal. God's not forcing you to do something against your will. No, he's basically saying, look, I want to use you for what you're really good at. You're really good at whatever that might be. And I want to use that for the kingdom, God, for kingdom of God. Not everybody's called to be a preacher. I'll tell you that right now. All right. You don't want to be a preacher unless God called you. You do not want this job. You do not want it unless God has called you to do this job. You do not want to do this job. Now, but if you've been called, then he enables you to do it. It's him. So whatever this package is that you're here listening to right now, it's only because of what he did to me to make me this. It's the way it works in the kingdom. That's how the kingdom works. You end up doing what God has called you to do. Because you what? Submit to the calling. You submit to his free will. Now, it works good because why? Because God knows better than you. But he will not force his will upon you. He will not. You can do whatever you want. You can do whatever you want. God can only work with your want to. God, Heavenly Father, can only work with your want to. What you want to do. What you want to do. What is it that you want to do? That's what God, the Heavenly Father, is asking you when you get born again, brought into the kingdom. What do you want to do? I want to help you do what you want to do. No, healing for our body works the same way. No, yes, healing for your physical body works exactly the same way. It works through your want to. What do you want to do about this sickness in your body? What do you want to do? Now, you can be sick. You can say, well, what do you want to do? Well, I want to go and do whatever the doctor tells me to do. Then go do it. Or you could say, oh, I want to be healed. Okay, then let's see what happens when you put your want to with what God wants to do with your want to. I'm going slow there so you can get it. Mark chapter 10, verse 46. Mark 10, verse 46 through 52. King James Version. Mark 10, 46 through 52. And they came to Jericho, and as he, Jesus, went out of Jericho with his disciples and a great number of people, blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the highway side begging. And when he, blind Bartimaeus, heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And many charged him, just said, oh, shut up, be quiet. But he cried the more, greater in deal, thou son of David, have mercy on me, he yelled out. Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called. And they called the blind man, saying unto him, be of good comfort, rise, he is calling you. He cast away his garment and rose and came to Jesus. And Jesus answered and said unto him, look what Jesus asked him. What wilt thou that I should do unto thee? What do you want? In other words, what is your want to? What do you want me to do for you? That's what Jesus asked. Now, in the natural, you could say, well, it's obvious, isn't it? He's blind. He can't see. You had to get people to bring him to you, all right? rather than you go to him. You made him, the people bring him to you. And you're asking him, what do you want me to do for you? Oh, come on. Everybody here knows he wants to see. But Jesus asked him, what do you want me to do for you? What was Jesus talking about? He was talking to his free will. What was your will? What do you really want? What do you really want? Because his healing is based upon what he wanted. Now, he could have wanted a lot of things. Well, being blind, you know, like it'd be nice if I had a new set of clothes, because like I'm really dirty and I'm filthy. Well, okay, fine. Now you can continue to be blind, but we'll get a new set of clothes for you. No, Pastor Wink, please, that's not what was going on here. Yes, that's what's going on here. Many times I've seen many people go into the hospital for whatever reason, and now they're in the hospital, and they're complaining about everything under the sun while they're now in the hospital. Why? Because they're in the hospital, they're getting all these visitors. Everybody's coming to see them. They never got so much attention in their entire life. Do they want to get better? Absolutely not. They want to be as sick as long as they possibly can be, because now all this commotion, all this love, all this attention, everybody really cares and loves me. I never got any of this prior to getting sick. So what does that person want? He wants to be, he or she wants to be sick longer. For what? For the sake of being sick? No, but because of the attention and the love. So what they're really crying out for, they're not getting. No one's paying any attention to them. You can say, that's not true. People are that stupid. Yes, people are that stupid. They are. They're that stupid. The blind man said unto him, unto Jesus, Lord, that I might receive my sight. That I might receive my sight. He answered the Lord what he really wanted. His will. He exposed his will that he would be able to see. And Jesus said unto him, Jesus didn't do any more but to just say these words. Jesus said unto him, go thy way, thy faith hath made thee whole. Didn't put his hands on his eyes. Didn't say a marvelous prayer. He just said, what do you want? I want to be able to see. Well, then go your way. Just go your way. Your faith has made you whole. That was the end of that. His healing was based upon what he wanted. His own free will was the thing that kept him blind. But now that Jesus came by, he had a choice to make. I could continue to be blind, or I could choose to receive healing from Jesus who's walking by. So he cried out. He made a choice. I want to be healed. Jesus, Son of God, have mercy upon me. You see how it works? Your free will actually heal you or not. Your free will actually heal you or not. It's based upon what do you want. What we want in life is very important. And our connecting what we want to and our desire to our free will is very important indeed about how our lives get better in this world. It has to do with our own free will. I can't make you be saved. I'd like the whole world to be saved. I'd like the whole world to be healed. But I can't make people healed, and I can't make people saved. It's their own choices in life. Why is 90% of the world going straight to hell, as we just read earlier? Why are so many people going straight to hell? Because they choose to go there. They've chosen to go. Don't tell me people haven't heard about Jesus Christ. They've had shows, TV shows every Easter and every Christmas about Jesus Christ. But what happens? People look and they just say, that's just Hollywood. That's just nonsense. No one who believes that. So what is their own free will made a choice not to believe? And consequently, they're still lost and they're still going straight to hell. Our free will is very important in regards to how God can or cannot help us in our circumstances and situations. We see these scriptures, what we see in these scriptures is that faith to be healed is directly connected to your want to. It's directly connected to your want to, your will to be healed. You have to have a will to be healed. I will be healed. You actually got to say it. You got to say it out of your mouth. I will be made whole. I will be made whole. I will, regardless of what the world or your body or your symptoms or whatever is trying to tell you. I don't care how many doctor's report come down. I'll say the same exact thing. I will be healed. I will. That's my will, and I'm stating it. I will be healed. I will. So, before you can exercise your faith to be healed, or to be saved, or to be financially blessed, you must first have the desire, you must want to first. You have to have the desire, and you must have the want to first, before anything else happens. You have to find out, what do I really want? How badly do I want it? And to what extent am I willing to go to get it, what I want? All right? You have to have the want to, the will first. Mark 11:24 says, therefore I say unto you, this is what Jesus is speaking, therefore I say unto you, what things soever you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them and you shall have them. So when do you do it? You believe you've received it when you pray. You don't believe you received it when you get it. You don't need to believe then. You can actually see it. It's there. You don't have to have any belief for it. So you have to believe you receive it when you pray. You connect your will to it and say, I receive it now. I will be saved. I am saved. I am healed. I am made prosperous. Statement. What you want to do is what you will to do. What you want to do is what you will to do. In other words, I can want to, but still not will do it. I can want to, but still not actually do it. So you have to have the will to do. Question. Is what you want to do what God wants you to do? That's the question. Is what you want to do what God wants you to do? If you want to move from an ordinary life to an extraordinary life, you must want to do God's will for your life, not your will. If you really want to live and to move from an ordinary Christian to an extraordinary Christian, you must want to do God's will. And to want to do God's will, you must submit your will to the will of the Father. 1 John chapter 2, verse 16 and 17 says, for all that is in the world, all that is in the world, lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, that's the attraction of the world. That's what keeps people into the clutches and the control of the world. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. In other words, all of that stuff is of the world. It has nothing to do with the kingdom of God. And the world, what? Passes away, and the lust thereof. But he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. So, if you want to make a choice for eternity, you'll stop living according to the lust of the flesh, the eyes, lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. And you'll start obeying the submissive to the will of God, because those who submit to the will of God and come down underneath the will of God and let the will of God direct their steps, they will live forever with God. Now, if we really mean business as a child of God, and we want to live forever with God, then we will learn to submit our free will to the will of the Father. The Apostle James tells us this, and our lives are so short and limited that we should not do anything unless it is the will of God. We should not do anything unless it's the will of God. So the biggest thing as a child of God is this your will, Father? Is what I'm being presented to me, is it what you want me to do? We see this in James chapter 4, verse 13 through 15. Go to now, ye that say, today or tomorrow, we will go into such a city and continue there a year, and buy and sell and get gain. Whereas you know not what shall be in the tomorrow, for what is your life? This is what James is saying. What is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little while, a little time, and then vanisheth away. When I heard that scripture the first time, I realized something. When I was a kid, as a teenager, I used to go to Vermont and live for the summer vacation with my uncle up in Vermont. He lived in a place called Sheffield, Vermont, and it was on a hill. His farm was up on the hill, and then the village was down in the valley. And every morning, we'd wake up in the morning and go out and sit and eat breakfast out on the front stoop. All right, there was a porch thing. And you could look from the front stoop of the house and look down the valley, and it was so filled with a cloud of a fog-like, but from up there, it was like a cloud, and it filled the entire valley, and you could not see any houses down there at all. All you could see was the top of this cloud. Now, I would sit there, and I would eat my breakfast, right? My aunt would make us eggs and bacon and all this kind of stuff, so it was plenty to eat. But it was so nice to sit out there in the cool of the morning air and smell those smells and then look at that. And by the time I was eating my breakfast, you know, not staring at the cloud, but over time, it just rose and dissipated and disappeared. And I thought, this is what the scripture means. That's what our life is like. It's like it was there and then we're gone. Our life is so short. Verse 15. For that we ought to say, James says, for that we ought to say, if the Lord will, get those words? If the Lord will, we shall live and do this or that. If that's the will of the Lord, that's what we'll do. It's not about me and what I want to do. It's always about what He wants to do and how I fit into His will and plan. Acts chapter 18, verse 21. This is what Apostle Paul says, the same thing. But bade them farewell, saying, I must by all means keep this feast that cometh in Jerusalem. But I will return again unto you, listen to these words, if God will. And he sailed for Ephesus. In other words, he's basically saying, I'd like to come back to you, and I'd like to see you again. But it's really up to the will of God as whether I come back or not. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 19, he says all this, but I will come to you shortly if the Lord will, and will know not the speech of them which were puffed up, but of power. So we see is we must follow their example and only fulfill the will of God for our life. If we're really going to live a good, holy, and righteous life and truly be servants of the Lord Jesus Christ, then we have to what? We have to completely submit our will to the will. And so whatever I do, wherever I go, yes, I love you all, I want to be with you all, but guess what? I want to be there with you and love with you all from the standpoint of, is it the will of God to come back and see you again? Then fine, it'll be the will of God to come back and see you again. Praise the Lord. So God has an intention. His intention for us is to live according to His plan and purpose. Now, what that really basically comes down to is, Pastor Marion's going to come, is that what it comes down to is the fact is this, is that God wants us to realize that I'm not forcing you to do anything. But as you come and work with me each and every day, He's basically saying to us, look, have I ever done anything wrong to you? Have I ever been mean to you and treated you badly? Has not my plans always worked out good for you? Doesn't it really think about it?
Yes.
It always works out good for us. So you got to say to yourself, well, what am I worried about? That God will make me do something that's going against my will? No, He's not going to make you do anything. He already knows you anyway. He knows what you like or don't like.
That's right.
But whatever He asks us to do, it's really not extraordinary. He's going to start out asking you to do something simple and test you to see if you really are submissive, and then go from there. That's the process of developing your relationship with Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit within you. But it really comes down to the only way you're really going to do that, all right, to do the will of God, is you have to first submit your will to the Heavenly Father.
Amen.
Praise
Amen.
The Lord.
Amen. You know, I'm listening to you when you talked about in Vermont and as a young kid sitting on the porch.
Yeah.
And it's I'm sitting there listening to you, and it's almost like you could go back and smell the smells.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And what comes to my mind is when you talked about your life fleeting, like the fog lifting up, we need to live every day and enjoy the day.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's here today and it's gone tomorrow.
Yeah.
And I think sometimes we take for granted the things that we have in that day, and we're so busy trying to project for tomorrow that today is just flying by.
Yeah, it really is.
You know, so it's like I'm just encouraging us and you to just take the day when you get up in the morning and just thank God for it.
Yeah.
And how interesting submission and then with the offering message, commitment, just fit together. And again, never know what you're going to talk about.
I know, it does.
Vice versa.
Yeah.
But it's really when we submit to God, when we commit to God, we can take that day and trust Him for tomorrow.
Amen, we can.
And enjoy today.
Amen.
So.
And that's what God really wants. He wants us to be happy all the time, all right? And there's no reason why we shouldn't, all right? But what happens to a lot of Christians is that things in the world happen and they see it as an attraction. But sometimes Satan will bait us to look over here, see what's going on over here. You could have a part of this if you just forget with this whole God stuff for a moment and just spend some time over here with me, all right? So we're baited to see if we will bite the bait of it. But in actuality, there's nothing over here that you really want anything to do with. The world is something that's going where it's going. But now that you're in the kingdom, God wants you to have an incredible life. And He will help you to realize and be the significant, simple things about life that make us all very, very happy to be a child of God. And that's the part that we need to focus in on.
Amen. It's really deception that He uses.
Yeah, He does.
You know, I'll never forget, it was like on New Year's Eve or New Year's Day, they'd always have the Twilight Zone or the Outer Limits marathon, one of them things.
Right.
So we used to watch those, and I'll never forget the one episode where the guy was in the elevator, and he was able to go down, and it looked like on the floor that he wanted to go off on, it was great, everything he could ever imagine, the clothes, the food. And he pressed that button, and when the elevator opened, he went in, and just for a few minutes, it looked so good, until he realized he was in hell.
Yeah.
Do you remember that?
I remember that.
All right? And that's really what the devil does. Yeah. He uses this deception to make his world look so good.
I know.
Where for that fleeting moment, it looks so great and is really a mirage of where he wants to take us.
Absolutely.
Which brings me to the point of I'm listening to your messages and my messages. And again, I'm sitting there and I'm listening and it comes to me. Jesus said, I'm going to make you fishers of men. Mm-hmm. Well, when you pull a fish, I'm not into fishing, but I've watched enough people fish and things on TV. Mm-hmm. When you pull the fish out of the water, you just don't eat it. You have to clean it, mm-hmm. right? And if first it has to die and then kill, you know, and then right. cook it and clean it and cook it.
Yeah.
And it's really what this whole ministry is, John 3:16.
It is.
Right? We're fishers of men. We're going to give an altar call to invite you into the kingdom. But we're really a teaching ministry where we take the fish and clean you up. Not that we're going to cook you or eat you.
Yeah.
All right? But it's like we're cleaning you up. Yeah. And that's what the teaching of the word does.
It does.
It
yes.
prepares you. And yeah. especially the messages lately. We don't want anybody to just be in the presence of God and Him look at you and say, I never knew you. So these messages really are cleaning you and discipling yeah.
Amen.
You and training
Amen.
You.
Amen.
For kingdom purpose and eternal life.
Yes.
And that's really, I saw that a lot in what you preached here this morning.
Glory to God.
So, praise
Glory
God.
To God. God wants us to, He wants us to see, look, as much as you think you're attracted to the world, I have so much more to offer you, but I'm giving you at a piecemeal. Why? Because you need to learn to make choices yeah. for the kingdom. And that requires your submission to His will to get that accomplished. So it's a learning process. But as we do and we get closer to Him and interact with Him more, what happens is that we just don't have time for the world anymore. We just want to spend more time with Him. So if you're on this fence, if you're at this point in your life and you really have never received Christ as your Savior, we have an altar call after every service. Why? Because there's the potential possibility somebody could be listening tonight, or to this morning, that is, and actually be hearing these scriptures and hearing these principles and saying, I don't know where I'm going to go when I leave this world and what's going to happen. Well, God wants you to know that you have a right to eternity with Christ Jesus and the rest of us.
Amen.
All right? And the way you get there is just simply receive His Son as your Savior, Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father sent His Son for a purpose. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Yeah. So, to get a hold of that everlasting life and be a part of what Jesus has already bought and paid for you, pray this prayer with us. Say it out loud and mean it from your heart. Say, Heavenly Father,
Heavenly Father,
I believe that Jesus is the Christ.
That Jesus is the Christ.
The Son of the living God.
The Son of the living God.
He died for me.
He died for me.
Went to hell in my place.
Went to hell in my place.
He arose from the dead.
He arose from the
and
dead.
And ascended into heaven.
And ascended into heaven.
Lord, I ask you this day.
Lord, I ask you this day.
Please forgive me.
Please forgive me.
Of all my past wrong.
Of all my past wrong.
I repent of it.
I repent of it.
I turn from it now.
I turn from it now.
I receive your salvation.
I receive your salvation.
And I make you my Lord.
And I make you my Lord.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Oh, glory, glory, glory,
Amen.
Glory. The Bible tells us the angels are rejoicing in heaven for your decision this day in receiving Christ Jesus. Another child entering
glory
into the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Glory, glory,
Lord.
Glory for what you have done. And so, praise the Lord. Need to tell somebody, call us on the number on the bottom of the screen at 845-546-6365. God wants us to know that you received Christ today and that we can then congratulate you and help you in any way we can in your growth and development as a child of God.
Amen.
It is glorious every time someone enters the kingdom of God. All the bells and whistles of heaven, so to speak, and just go off and everyone rejoices at another saved child of God. So we thank God for you. And the rest of you, all of you, we pray the blessings of God upon each and every one of you as you continue to live and move and have your being in Christ, that God will help you each and every day in your submission to His free will and be able to do the work that God has called us, each and every one of us, to do, to bring more souls into the kingdom of God. We pray for each and every one of you for excellent health and wholeness.
Amen.
No matter what you might be going through, we thank God for the Word
yes.
and for the Holy Spirit that delivers you from everything that the enemy might bring against you. In Jesus' name. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
We will see you on Thursday night. Pastor Mary will be back for another incredible message. In the meantime, walk with the King and be a blessing to someone in your life.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. God bless you.